Okay, watch your mouth. Mm-hmm. Watch your mouth.
Okay, my makeup artist didn't get my hair fixed.
Here. You can put some makeup on if you want.
Okay.
You want a hat or anything? Are you comfortable with your hair like that?
Oh.
No, you're fine. I'm kidding, Mike. Mike, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. I'm kidding. I'm kidding. I'm kidding.
I look good enough for radio.
Yes. Let's back that down just a little bit. And there we go. I'd turn it up there. The other day.
Mm-hmm.
How's that?
That is good.
Okay. You ready?
Yes.
Here we go.
And now for something special. The unit is self-contained with its own saddler, farrier, wheelwright, and so on. It's a rigorous training dished on who know all there is to know about horses, and it brings results. We take you behind the scenes now to show just some of the interesting aspects of this training.
Welcome back to Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein, the number one podcast to create sounder horses from the ground up. Mike Stein is a registered journeyman farrier with an APF 1 accreditation. On this week's show, Mike dives into that 60-minute episode about horse raping, horse doping. Race. Hold on, let me finish. Horse racing doping investigation. Also, we're going to talk about the proper balance, chapter 11, the balance of a rider, and also a discussion about the Ray Morris video, the reason why about saddle fitting. All this and much, much more will be discussed here on Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. And over to my far hand side is Mike Stein. How are you?
I'm doing good, Travis. How are you?
Well, I'm doing okay. For some reason, I've got this pain in the back of my neck here.
It's me.
Yeah, it feels like you back here. I've done something wrong. I've twisted my neck. So bear with me if I look a little stiff on the camera. And don't forget, for every podcast we do, we have a matching video. You can see us here in the studio, me waving a mic, Mike waving me. What do you got to say over there,
Mike?
You
were talking to me about my hair and my makeup this morning. I told you I had the perfect radio face.
Yes, and here I am struggling, trying to keep a stiff neck from pulling me down. Now, something that is going to happen here in the next week is my wife got so excited this past Saturday. We were sitting there at breakfast, and she gets a text on her tablet and stuff. She's like, oh my God, I'm so excited, I'm so excited. I'm like, what? And it's one of those where she doesn't tell me anything because she's sitting there typing back. I'm like, what is it? She's typing, what is it? Oh my God, I can't type. What is it? My saddle came in. I said, your saddle? She's like, yeah, I bought a new saddle. I said, oh, I thought you bought that like 4 weeks ago. It's not here yet? She's like, no, it's coming from Germany. And I said, okay. She's like, it's caught up in customs, and they're doing all this other stuff with it. And I guess it finally made it through customs is what she meant to say.
Yes.
And now it's at the dealer, and they're going over quality control of this saddle. Now, I'm going to read what she bought. She bought a dress saddle, a Verdatis extra wide tree with a hish head and short panels.
Say that three times fast.
Well, she wrote it down real quick for me on this post-it note. And so I'm just reading her handwriting here, and that's what it is. All that means absolutely nothing to me. Does that make sense to you?
Oh, yes, it makes perfect sense. How much how much is that hitting your checkbook for?
Well, here's what she's trying to explain to me. And right. You can never, it's one of those things where when a woman goes to the store and buys everything on sale and saved you $200, but spent $500, and you're
right.
Like, oh, but
it was a great deal.
It was a great deal. She's got a horse saddle right now. I believe, I'm not sure what it is. I don't want to mistake or misspeak by telling her what saddle it is. But it's got to be the same saddle because she's getting a trade-in on that saddle. So it's got to be a dress saddle. So they're giving her 70% of whatever the value of that saddle was towards the cost of the saddle that she's buying. For some reason, I think we're still shelling out like $6,000. So if you do the math there, I don't know.
Have you been in trading vehicles?
No, I haven't.
Okay.
So that's what she's getting. Now you say, Travis, why are you getting a new saddle?
Travis, why are you getting a new saddle?
Because Diego, who's now 5 years old and has been doing these, extra heavy duty lifting and not moving and all the other stuff, his back and everything has gotten wider,
right?
And they completely exhausted the saddle. His baby saddle, his training wheel saddle,
right,
is getting too small for him. It's not fitting him right anymore. So go ahead.
Yes, you're correct. Yes, if we're developing good strong back, they will broaden out, And guess what? There will be another one and another one.
I thought when you bought one saddle, that was it. It was like saddles for life or something like that. I mean, you buy a saddle, you put it on the horse.
It's like you buying a pair of shoes when you're 9 years old, right?
But
You're still wearing the same shoes?
Not when I'm nine. Since I was 13, I think I've worn the same size shoes since I was 13.
Okay. And nothing's changed.
Nothing's changed. I've gone a little taller. I've gotten, my weight's gone up and down. My feet are still the same. So why can't saddles be the same?
Because they're just not.
I know. Tell me about it. So anyway, she's excited, and I guess it's down at the saddle fitter right now, and it's being flocked and fluffed and all that stuff mm-hmm. to make sure that it is to the point. Now, this is what gets me upset. She had a county saddler out here.
Right.
Drove in, she gave her the whole sob story about driving all the way over here from, three states over and all the other stuff that goes along with saddling. And my wife wrote it and was like, this is nice. I'm excited. This is going to be a brand new saddle for, at the time, Dominique. But she gets that way. And then she puts the saddle on and it just doesn't work right. So the saddle fitter comes out and flocks it again and gets three flockings for free to get the right. saddle to work. And then it still doesn't work. So she has to turn around and give it back or resell it or something like that. It's just not working.
Right.
And I think sometimes she just kind of jumps right into buying a new saddle. She gets excited and all that instead of like sitting there and actually, listening and doing all that stuff. Now, believe me, my wife is very, very knowledgeable as far as riding horses and all that stuff. I just think the saddle fitting, I mean, you're basically, there's a couple things that you need to choose in life when you have a horse,
right.
The saddle and the farrier. And then,
the saddle fit thing is just as controversial as the whole thing with farriers.
So, she's, I don't want to say learned her lesson, but she's figuring out, okay, this does not work on my horse. I know what to look for next time.
Right.
So it's kind of like when you buy a new car, you're like, oh, it's all nice and shiny. And you get in it and like a year later, you're like going, this button broke off. And they're like, oh, this thing's a piece of garbage compared to what I thought it was. So that's where we're at right now. But hopefully this new saddle, she's got one already. Like I said, it's a dresh, and she's turning around and getting another one. It's got a different tree on it. I'll see if I can read that one more time. It's a Verdades, extra wide tree, high head, and short panels. So that's the if that gives you an outline of what Diego looks like.
And he's relatively straight back, too.
He is somewhat straight back, I guess. I don't know. I'm just regurgitating what you're telling me. All right, guys, so stick around. When we come back, we're going to dive into that 60-minute episode this past Sunday that was talking about doping racing horses, and how the federal investigations are getting involved in that as well. So stick around. You're listening to Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. He'll be right back. You good?
Yes, I am.
I'm going to go to camera 6 on this one so we can pull up the watch the video at the same time. Ready?
Yes, I am.
Welcome back to Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. If you have a question for Mike Stein, the way you get a hold of him is to go to equinedynamics.com. At the top of the page says contact us. Fill out that little form there with your question. Put a return address on there. And we still have a handful of these Dover Saddler cards, gift cards to hand out to you. So make sure you fill out that little form. Put a return address and we'll mail this out to you. And also, we'll send you a prize pack as well. So do that over equinedynamics.com. Top of the page says contact us. And over to my far hand side is Mike Stein. How are you?
I'm doing good. Travis, how are you doing, sir?
Doing all right. So tell me what you were doing the other night. Sunday night, you were sitting around.
Sunday night.
Flocking your saddle.
Flocking my saddle.
And you were watching the 60-minute program.
Yes, I was. Our friend Todd Centero sent me a message, watch 60 minutes.
Okay, and here's if don't forget, for every podcast we do, we have a matching video over on YouTube. Make sure you like and subscribe over there, and I'm going to switch to camera 6, and we can keep watch this short little clip from that episode of 60 Minutes.
And there's one furlong to run.
It was a sweet finish to this year's Kentucky Derby. A stealth newcomer named Mage defying 15-1 odds to win the race.
Mage has done it!
But the celebration at Churchill Downs capped off a startling run-up to the race. Five horses were scratched, including the favorite, Forte. And then there was the death toll, a dozen at the height of this year's season, leading the track to temporarily suspend racing. Investigators were unable to find a singular explanation for their fatalities. Take Charge Brianna injured her front leg and was euthanized. Lost in Limbo hurt his leg, collapsed on the track, and was later put down. Then in Maryland, on the day of the Preakness Stakes, this horse named Having a Meltdown threw off his jockey after injuring his front leg and also had to be euthanized.
Having a meltdown lost the rider.
In June, we spoke with the woman newly charged with trying to make the sport safer, Lisa Lazarus, the chief executive officer of HISA, the Horse Racing Integrity and Safety Authority.
People who are not in your world see this headline of more than a dozen dead horses, and they think, what is going on in that industry?
And my response to that is, HISA is here now, and we're going to address it.
Well, where was she before, Mike? I mean, you know, here they are now addressing it, and this is something that just hasn't popped up. And I'm going to switch back the camera here so you can see us here in the studio. So I guess now the federal law or federal government's getting involved with this?
Right. Well, horse racing has always been regulated state by state.
Okay.
As far as doping, doing stuff to block pain, performance enhancers, they've always, you know, been people looking at that to different degrees. And there have been people caught over the years. They're gambling over millions and millions of dollars, and there are people playing dirty. There are some very stand-up, you know, people in horse racing that really try to do it right. And
unfortunately, they're losers.
Unfortunately.
No, I'm kidding about that, but I mean...
Well, no. Not completely, because, you know, the people that I used to work for were so anti anything as far as that goes. And they had been at tracks and they've seen the stuff. Cause you know, Miss Nora passed away at 95 years old and spent her whole life around horse racing. And if anybody was to go off about somebody using anything from elephant tranquilizer was used at one time, they used snake venom to block pain. It's amazing. Some of the stuff that has been done, and they're talking about people altering drugs just a little bit to get around the test. And apparently this goes all the way back to drug manufacturers, labs, everything else, it sounds like to me. And there's millions of dollars passing hands.
Now, several years ago when we started this podcast,
right,
one of the things that I made it clear that my wife does not like horse racing. Now, she does hunter jumpers, she does dressage.
Right.
And when I first met her, when we first started dating, she said, you know, because they do so bad things. And it's this aura that they do a lot of bad things to those horses.
Right.
And they run them to, you know, I don't want to say run them till they're dead, but they train them so hard. Their schedule, their maintenance and everything is so hard and so regimented. And they do have to put all these drugs and stuff on them. And that's not regulated to a certain point.
Oh, it's regulated.
Yeah,
getting more regulated all the time.
Yeah, but when you've got this $2 million horse and you stand to win, you know, or make, you know, $10 million on this horse as an owner, you know, I can see money easily slipping through people's pockets, you know, real easy. Hey, turn your eye this way. Don't look this way. Ignore that test this way. And this is a result of what's happening. It's sad that the federal government now has to step in,
right?
Because we've got so many other things that the federal government can basically take care of, but now they're making this focus group. And who even knows if that is corrupt or if it's legit or who's on the board that actually knows, you know, what to look for.
Well, part of the problem was every state had their own rule book. So each state had a different set of rules to a degree.
Right.
I know I worked for a fella that was involved in regulating horse racing, Tex. What's Tex's last name? They always called him Tex. But anyway, he was pretty tough, and they weren't going to get over on him. But they, you know, the end of the day, there's a lot of things done behind the scenes. I think that you'll find it's a small part of them that are doing it. course, if they're getting away with it, a few more will try. You know, there are people out there that, you know, that are horse racing, depending on the level they're at, that probably have never and never even thought about doing this sort of thing with their horses. And it's like, you know, somebody from some neighborhood sells drugs, so they're all drug salesmen. That's not true. But something really needs to be done. It's like FEI, they will test. I mean, they've companies that have changed hoof packings to set the FEI regulations so that we can use that hoof packing on a horse that is showing FEI. And
what is FEI sample?
This is the people that are like the international, the three-day eventers, the jump show jumpers, the World Equestrian Games horses, and all that would fall under FEI.
Mm-hmm.
And the horses are passported, and you know, this is international competition. But they're, you know, they have, what the goal is to preserve the horse. You know, we want them out there doing stuff. It's like, because somebody, one person does something, do we tell your wife she can't do dressage? It's kind of the same deal with horse racing, with the people that are into horse racing.
Do you see horse racing going to the wayside as dog racing? Because, you know, you don't see dog tracks as much. I mean, there are some places that do have dog track racing and kennel racing, I guess is what they call them. You see a lot of that going away. There's a place in Orlando, Florida, Hi-Li, you know, the Hi-Li where they do the whole, with the ball, they got this big thing on their arm and they throw the ball off the wall.
Okay.
There was a Greyhound track out there as well, and it was full betting on both of that. And that has gone by, I think, in the early 2000s, that's gone away.
Is it possible? Yeah. If people don't clean their act up, eventually the government might say, guess what, guys, we're not doing this anymore.
Do you think it's maybe I touched on that a little bit. Maybe it's because there's betting on horses, and is there betting on dressage? Is there betting on eventing? Is there betting on horse or hunter jumpers as much as it would be betting on horse racing?
I don't think that you're seeing that like you would horse racing.
no, but you know, Christina on Golden Stallion is going to get a perfect score on dressage. You know, it's not that right. Way.
No, it's not that. It's not that way. And
now, 3-1 odds on that, please.
Right. And I think that may be part of why the government. There's a lot of money moving. There have been people busted for throwing races in years past. There was an older jockey that I talked to who was out of horse racing because of throwing races, and
yeah, when you
did some time behind bars for it,
like you said, when
so there's been being policed all along in different ways in different states, but it's really is with all these horses like right there at the Derby is very visible out in front of everybody.
And like you said, there's a lot of money exchanging hands, and it's right. So easily to be corrupt. I mean, look at what they're trying to do now with just sports betting. And, you know, there a lot of places don't want to have sports betting, you know, like on baseball or hockey or any football or anything like that. Yeah. And that's slowly creeping in. And I guarantee you're going to see a lot more corruption, quote unquote corruption, and things in the regular sport industry just because of how much money is going to exchange hands. If there's a pocket to be filled, it'll be open for someone.
Yeah, I mean, because people are greedy, because people are willing to, you know, play dirty pool, break the rules, and all that kind of stuff, it could destroy the sport of kings.
But and just think,
I hope not, because you know, on the other end, everybody says all race horses are torn up. They are not. There are horses that have gone on to to the Olympics and I know this because I've worked on some, and I know where there's one standing now that went to the Olympics that was a racehorse. Mm-hmm. They've been to other disciplines and have been healthy horses for a long time, but those horses probably were not juiced up. They were not overworked. They were taken care of, and they had long careers, second careers after being a racehorse.
Yeah. You look at like your dressage riders and all the other eventing horses, they ride for the love of riding the horse.
Right.
And, you know, two for the competition and three for the elegance of it. Horse racing is not, it's not all three of those, you know?
Right. And there are plenty of horses that have come off the track that have had long careers. true. There are horses that come off the track damaged. There are horses that have done nothing but dressage, nothing but trail ride, nothing but anything that have gotten damaged younger than they should have been.
Yeah.
So it can happen. It does happen sometimes due to our ignorance, sometimes to overpushing, sometimes to a lot of things. But on the other end, just because a racehorse doesn't mean they're destroyed.
So if a horse fails or gets fined or something like that, does the whole team, from the owner to the trainer to the rider to the farrier to whoever laid hands on that horse, do they receive that fine, or is it one person that receives that fine?
I can't tell you that one. I've never been in that situation. I don't plan on being there.
I hope you don't either, Mike. All right, guys, stick around. When we come back, we'll get into the proper balance movement, chapter 11, the balance of a rider, and talking about saddle fitting. So stick around. You're listening to Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. He'll be right back. Touchy subject, Mike.
Touchy
subject.
Yeah, it really is.
Goddamn reading. My eyes are bad enough as it is.
Well, it's because if you had your eye makeup on, you'd look better.
My little eyeshadow on?
Yeah. Do you want my hardware store magnifying glass?
No, I'm good.
Yeah, my wife says, I don't need glasses. I've got the hardware store magnifying glass. See, you do need glasses. No, I don't.
Ready?
Yes.
Welcome back to Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. Don't forget to follow him over on Facebook. Search Equine Dynamics Mike Stein. What? What's wrong?
Nothing. I'm just making noise.
Okay.
I'm incoherent. Okay. Babbling.
So make sure you follow Mike Stein over on Facebook. Search Equine Dynamics Mike Stein, and you can see all the different articles that Mike posts up there. Furthering education. Make sure you like and subscribe to him over there as well. And don't forget, if you want to get some of these Dover Saddler gift cards, go over to equinedynamics.com. Fill out that little form there at the top of the page. It says contact us and ask a question if you like, and we'll put a return address and we'll mail one out to you as well, and a whole bunch of prize packs. And over my far end side, my very own prize pack is Mike Stein. How are you?
I'm doing wonderful, Travis. How are you doing today, sir?
Doing all right. You look good. You always look good, Mike. You got a nice flannel on today. It's a cool 53 degrees here in the Charlotte, North Carolina area. I reseeded my pasture the other day for the horses.
Yes.
And I bought a 125-pound bag of horse pasture seed.
Horse pasture seed.
Guess how much that was?
$60.
$100, Mike, for 125-pound bag of seed.
Pepper says she's worth it.
No, Cayenne says she's worth it.
Excuse me, Cayenne says she's worth it.
And Diego, or Dominique says
she knows she's worth it.
And I had to get two bags out there. So
one for each.
Yeah, exactly. So I aerated the soil and stuff, and then went out there with a spreader. And then we got a little bit of rain. Hopefully that washed it in. And then I got to wait another 3 months for it to pop up. So
right.
Hopefully we'll have nice pasture grass for next year. Now we're going to get into this book here, The Proper Balance Movement, A Diary of Lameness, written by a mentor of Mike Stein, Tony Gonzalez. I see Anthony all the time. It throws me.
Anthony Zachary Gonzalez.
Yep. And he was a... He was
from A to Z, from the beginning to the end.
And he was a farrier, and he's the one who kind of created a whole bunch of different methods and methodology that we use somewhat today. And some of the stuff over time and new products have come out. We've changed our situation as far as what we use, as far as farrying a horse or shotting a... Shotting one as well. But this one right here, where he's going to talk about... And we're going to continue on chapter 11, basically talking about the a horse rider sitting in the saddle and leaning off to the side. We were talking about carrying water buckets and everything. So we continue with this, and I'm reading from his book. So here it goes. It is important not only to observe the horse's movement with the rider upon its back, but also to analyze the rider's position as well. I have, meaning Tony, worked on almost every type of breed, and they all have motion, lameness in common. Let me turn page 2. If a horse is unable to move its leg from the shoulder because the shoulder is constricted by the rider, then the horse will be forced to use a fetlock and the knee action in order to move its leg forward. This upward arc leads the horse to look like it's covering a lot of ground when it's actually making small strides. The rider's position may be too far forward on the horse's withers, interfering with the freedom of the back and the downward swing of the shoulder blade. Page 3. The rider's imbalance could cause a poorly fitted saddle, even by the wrong equipment being used, such as the breast collar or to hold the saddle forward. So he talks about the fitting of a saddle here,
right?
And how important it is. Now maybe that's I feel a little bit better about my wife buying this new dress saddle
because you saw that in Tony's book.
Because I saw that in Tony's book, and you're going to tell me why my wife needs a new saddle for our 5-year-old Diego, our gelding, because the one that was on him, I guess he's outgrown it. He's outgrown his baby saddle.
Right. Did you ever do any backpacking?
Me?
Yes.
Yeah, I went through Europe for 3 years. I was backpacking.
Did you have a good fitting pack frame?
I just had like my old JanSport backpack.
Okay.
And a pocket full of money.
Pocket full of money helps.
It was on one side, so right. I kind of walked funny.
Right. Well, I'm just kind of shooting in the dark on this one. But I know that some packs have pack frames.
Yes, they do. Yeah.
They do.
I went through the cities and not the mountains.
Oh. You're one of those.
Yes.
Did you backpack on a taxi?
Sometimes on the back of a Vespa.
Ah, Vespa backpacking. Yeah. Yes, I gotcha.
Okay,
you're in the mountains, right?
Right.
Your backpack frame doesn't fit your back. It's got pressure points.
Mm-hmm.
After a while, what happens?
I put the backpack down and say, I'm never doing this again.
Yeah, but you got some person who strapped that backpack to you, and they're going to jump on it, and they may be sitting on the backpack sideways. And you've got to keep going because they've got spurs. Yes. Anyway, so that's kind of the deal with the saddle in between the rider. And, the rider weight, shifting the saddle can make the saddle pinch on one side. It can drive the point of the tree into a shoulder and create a hollow if the rider is sitting uneven. If the saddle tips the rider too far forward, or, does not allow the rider to sit in the center of the seat and to keep their position balanced, that creates a problem for the horse. If your saddle is pulled up too far forward, and I'm guilty of this because we saddle horse up, ride a little bit, the saddle shifts back. So you put a breastplate on them. We'll pick on the breastplate. Okay. If a breastplate's not a bad thing, if you got a rope and a horse is going to blow out of a roping box at 30 miles an hour, 0 to 30 in about 5 feet, that saddle is going to pull back hard. If you're riding in rough terrain, maybe you need it, maybe you don't. But it needs to have enough room for the horse's shoulders to move if you're going to use one. Most time, like if you put a saddle on a horse, if you rock it, it'll kind of settle back and settle into a sweet spot where it likes to sit. Anybody out there, they need to have a friend work with them a little bit. Lay your hand up on the horse's shoulder. Have somebody take that leg up and lift the leg, catch it below the knee, bring it forward, shift the shoulder back, shift the shoulder back forward, rotate the shoulder, and feel what that scapula is trying to do. If your saddle's interfering with that, well, the horse can't move. If we've got a saddle slid up too far forward and the horse is you want your horse to really extend, the scapula cannot rotate back. They cannot truly extend. You get a false extension and the knees come up and they're bending out of the elbow because they're not able to rotate the scapula back.
So what happens if the saddle's too far backwards? You always talk about the saddle being too far forward.
Well, typically what I see is people pulling the saddle too far forward. If you have one too far back and it's dipping down and it ends up sitting onto the points of the tree, it'll drive the back down. Also getting into the loin, if you're getting too far back and making the lower back sore and you want a horse to come through and collect, there again, if it hurts to lift up into it, you're not going to do it, right?
I'm not going to do it.
You're not going to do it. The horse isn't going to do it.
We want him
to come through at the back end. If we're tying up the shoulders, it's physically impossible for them to come up through the back end. If we're making the lower back hurt with it, and you know, if the sweet spot of the saddle is slightly lifted, or the back slightly lifted, horse can work slightly lifted, which we want him to, with dressage or anything else. If the horse is fit to a down, the saddle's fit to a down back, it's kind of like I've got a really distorted bad foot on a horse, and I fit a shoe to the really distorted bad foot. What I'm doing is creating a really distorted bad foot situation instead of setting up around center mass, center of the bone column. So same thing with a saddle. If it is fit to a back that is pressed down, we want a horse to lift and round and come through. You can't come through if it hurts.
Why can't we just ride them bareback? I mean,
why can't we?
I don't know. I don't ride horses. I told you, I'm the simpleton here. I don't ride horses. I even was asking my wife the other day. She's like, I'm going to go ride Dominique. And I said, okay, what saddle are you going to use? Are you going to use that old Western one in there? She's like, no, I'll just bareback them. And she was just going to do like a walk trot, you know, around the arena and that type movement. But I'm like going, so, okay, bareback, you know, okay. I mean, I understand saddle and bare. I mean, I'm not an complete right. idiot, but I mean,
let's don't say that. let's not say that.
Not just yet, right?
Not yet.
All right, but I mean, you know, bareback, can you still achieve somewhat of a good movement?
Can you?
I don't know. I don't. These are the questions that I ask.
Can a rider ride balanced?
On a
maybe not.
Yeah.
Also, on a horse's bareback, this goes back to doing, you know, having some body work background. If someone put your hand up on your tailbone,
all right,
and sit on it.
Oh,
exactly. Feel that hard little lump called your pelvis.
Yeah, it's hurting my neck.
Yeah, well, that's not what we were going for. Anyway, if somebody rides bareback consistently, and you're massaging a horse's back on either side of the spine, about where your pelvis is sitting, it's not uncommon to find a hard knot in the longissimus in the back, and we massage that out. It's right about where your tailbone's hitting. So the saddle's pressure out is pounds per square inch. You got all that weight on that little tiny point. It drives in deep. Like with a Western saddle, you've got great big panels, and sometimes you can get away with a little bit more with a Western saddle because you got great big panels, and you spread it out on a big area, so it's less pounds per square inch. It's like I can take this and press on your back or put the same pressure on this knuckle on your back.
Yeah, don't do that.
Don't do that. That'll hurt, right?
It will hurt.
Well, and then you got somebody bouncing along on it, and you're doing this kind of thing on the horse's back.
Easy on the equipment, Mike.
And I'm messing with your equipment, banging on the table. But that kind of gets the point across, correct?
Right, yes, exactly.
So
bareback at a minimum.
And I'm not going to say that it – but also – it's like Ray used to say. He said, you got a horse that works every day, climbs mountains every day, has a really strong back. He said, you can put a saddle on a horse almost backwards. He said, they'll go fine because they're strong enough to. Most of our horses' backs are not as strong as what we think. Too many horses are not prepared for the job. And we jump on and we go and we're gonna do that. Think about these ranch horses that go hours and hours and hours all day. Of course, most of them have some really well-built ranch saddles, and it still needs to fit the horse. But they go long, slow pace for hours. Then you got a horse that stands and stall 99% of the time to go out and work. And we got a pressure point on the saddle. As far as strength of the back, the one that works all day is going to have a much more stable and strong back. Then you got a horse that has a drop shoulder. So if I got a horse that has a collapsed shoulder, weak shoulder, that whole saddle will want to twist with that. So sometimes we've got to work with that, some little pad work or whatever. The ideal thing is get your horse, pay attention to what's going on with your horse as far as development. Work with your trainer, work with your farrier, and take care of the uneven development and get your horse evened out. And then you can get the saddle to center up in the horse. Because an uneven rider can cause a shoulder to drop by digging one side of the saddle in, and the horse tries to get away from it. Vice versa, an even horse can dump a rider sideways.
All right, guys, we're going to take a short little break, and when we come back, Mike mentioned about Ray Morris, and we have a short little video, a small little snippet that we're going to play from his video that's available on Mike Stein's YouTube page. So stick around. You're listening to Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. He'll be right back.
Sorry, I got carried away with the beating on the table.
It's all right.
It kind of works for that, though, doesn't it?
Yeah. As my levels, my needles are all going bing, 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 bing.
Sorry. You know when you're dealing with imbeciles, what happens, right?
You're all right.
Yeah, sure. You're just saying that.
Welcome back to Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. Like I said, follow him over on YouTube. For every podcast we do, we have a matching video, and those videos contain all the visual elements that we have here in the studios. If we play a little video clip, you can see it in real time as we're talking about it. We also have a camera set up on past episodes where Mike has brought in freeze-dried legs, horse legs and stuff to give a demonstration here in the studio. We have a special camera for that. So for you to enjoy that and see it in real time as we're talking about it, go over to YouTube, subscribe, and make sure you share that with all your horse-loving friends out there. And we'd like to share something with you, anyone that comments on those videos in the next, for the rest of November. Let's do it that way. For the rest of November, we've got a couple Dover Saddler gift cards. We'll give them out until they're all gone. So comment on those videos over there, and I'll reach out to you and get your mailing address, and we'll send those out to you. And over to my far-hand side is Mike Stein. How are you?
I'm doing good, Travis. How are you doing?
Doing all right. Now, we've got a little video here. Now, many years ago, you teamed up with a gentleman in New Zealand by the name of Ray Morris.
Ray Morris,
Ray yes. Morris is a blind gentleman who's a horse masseur and a saddler. Is that correct by saying that?
Yes.
And so on Mike Stein's YouTube video, Ray Morris produced a 45-minute long audio disc, DVD or CD, if you guys remember what those are. And we've kind of chopped those up into different segments, and those are available in their entirety over on the YouTube channel, just broken up in small little bite-sized segments so you can listen to them at your leisure and not get carried away with them. And this is just a small little segment from one of those videos. So I'm going to turn this up right here, and here we go. So this is Ray Morris from the video collection called The Reason Why.
Hi, I'm Ray Morris. I'm a saddle fitter and equine masseur, and this track is called The Reason Why. And I guess the reason why is how I got into saddle fitting in the first place. I was a saddle maker and would make a saddle for a horse, maybe a young horse, maybe a three-year-old. And after two or three years, that saddle wasn't fitting too well anymore. Or maybe even an older horse, say 10, 12, 14 years old. And that saddle wouldn't be fitting after a few years either. And I knew, well, there had to be some sort of problem. The horse would be moving fine to begin with. Everything was great. And then things started to go wrong generally around 6 months down the track. And I know a lot of other saddle makers have the same problem. People put it down to weight loss on the horses or too much work, an accident in the paddock, the horse not moving right. And in some cases they were right. In a lot of cases they were wrong. And what really brought me to the conclusion that there was something wrong with what I was doing and something wrong with the horse in the first place was one horse that I looked at. Was a little quarter horse, had a Western saddle and a dressage saddle. Went really well on the Western, not on the dressage. I've seen their other thing work, or they've gone well in their all-purpose or dressage saddle and not well on the Western. And when I looked at the two saddles, the bearing surfaces underneath are being quite different in the two saddles.
So that's a short little segment from Ray Morris, A Guide to Saddle Fitting. And I think there's like three parts up there. Let me switch back to camera seven there. So tell us a little bit about those videos that are available on your YouTube channel. And what have you learned from watching or listening to him and hanging out with Ray Morris?
Well, a lot. and he was measuring saddles for a couple of saddle companies for custom fit trees. One of them was a small outfit out of Australia, and I think they've been sold at this point. I think they were Icon or something like that. It was like a three-man operation, and they were doing custom-made dressage saddles. You had to pre-order them. They're all 6 months behind, and some of them came to the States because you know, at the time, you could do a lot more with luggage. And he would bring a saddle up and a duffel bag as far as part of his luggage, because they weren't charging so much for it, and they were letting you bring stuff that was...
The heyday of air travel.
Right, yeah. After a while, they started cracking down a bit. So all his saddle flocking tools, so these have been their animals. So then we ended up making a full set of saddle flocking tools. I forged them out and made to put handles on them and all that so that he would have another set here. And also one thing I'd done is make something like a great big crochet needle with a handle on it. So you could go in, if you had a knot, through your access hole, rotate, hook the knot, pull the knot out, and then you could reflock the hole. Because one problem that when saddles have been flocked, where someone has pushed a knot or the riding or whatever has bound up a knot in the wool in there, you kind of need to get the knot out.
So is that what they put in the saddle? Is it wool or is it different material now?
Well, there are some
companies. Not to get off topic, but I mean.
Some companies use some different materials. The classic is wool. And he had a certain wool that he brought from New Zealand with him that he liked for saddles, which is typically, I can't remember the name, which one it was exactly, that he liked to you know, use. So if you got that little knot in there, or if you got, you know, what I was taught when he was had me flocking saddles is always, of course, he was blind, but you go in behind the old flocking and you don't disturb what's against the back. If you go against that where the sweat has gotten into it, kind of mats up, and that's where you end up pushing a ball in it. So you want to stay around behind it. If you're filling it with your hand as you're going in, you can feel it start to ball and back out and leave it flat in there. But if you push a ball in there and it gets bound up, you've got to remove it and then refill the hole. I've had saddles that I've brought to the house, and I've got all the flocking tools, and Ray had me flocking saddles, but you know, like for horses that I was trying to saddle for, I had one that was flocked very uneven for a horse a woman had for sale that I was going to look at on one of my horses, a dressage saddle. And I looked at it, it was flocked so uneven, it's like, there's no way. And this was a synthetic flocking. I don't know the exact material, but I asked the woman, I said, do you mind if I do something with it? Because there's no way if I could see if this will even pretend to work with the horse. You know, we did some rough measurements on the tree and all that, and the width should have been okay. But it was flocked in real heavy. Horse had a drop shoulder. They flocked in real heavy on that drop shoulder to keep the saddle centered up. So I just stripped it out and reflocked it in the house, evened it up. And there were some lumps in it we took out.
So can you cheat and flock a saddle for a crooked horse and still get away with riding that horse properly?
The ideal situation would be, A, ride the horse properly.
Right, exactly. I mean, let's start there first. But I mean, are there some people that, well, I don't have the time to sit here and fix the horse?
Oh, sure. That happens all the time.
So let's flock this horse, you know, heavy on the right side. And
some of it is farrier related when it comes to uneven horses and the skills of the farrier. But ideally what you would do is start to build in that weak shoulder, use a shim in your pad, and start slowly slipping the shims out. Ray would make shims out of the commercial felt, and sometimes glue a stack together, and as he builds in, take one layer off, take a layer off, do little triangles that fit into the hollow. And the idea was you could take a pad and attach them with hot glue on the back of the pad and just remove them as need be till you got the shoulder strong enough. Because you don't want to just have the saddle dump into one side, but ideally, you would like to have an evenly flocked saddle and an evenly developed horse.
Now, in the evolution of like materials and stuff that we've created, you know, from the horseshoes going from steel to aluminum to all these other polymers and plastic shoes and all this other stuff that's coming out, 3D printed shoes. You were talking to me on the phone the other day about,
right?
And then you were talking about Ray had this special wool for flocking the saddles, and then you've said they're synthetic materials and everything. I have a, ready for this one? I have a memory foam bed.
Right.
Now that's the evolution of your mattress. Is there anything like a memory foam saddle that you can like kind of put on there and just kind of like
there are
good
some,
to go?
There are some foam filled saddles.
Now I'm talking that space age NASA memory foam.
There probably are some memory foam saddles.
Okay, that's what I want. That's the saddle I want to sit on.
And if it does not work with your horse, you've got a saddle that you really can't do a lot with.
Yeah, I
got
to trade it.
They've got saddles with the airbags in them. And the problem with the airbags is if you sit here, the air pushes this way. If you sit here, the air pushes this way. And sometimes those airbags go flat. If you're not...
Now, when you say airbags, not for crashing, for holding up the saddle.
Well, you can wear airbags for crashing.
Yeah, but that's the vest. But not on... There's no... When you say airbag for me, this guy, it's not... If the horse crashes, the airbag blows up and blows you off the horse. It's the actual...
That's good.
Because I know they have them
Hit the eject button.
Well, I know they have them for motorcycles. Right. That's why I say that. So I'm not...
No, this is a...
Not that dumb.
A couple of air bladders between the leather or synthetic material between the tree.
To make up space.
To make up space.
Yeah, yes. To make up space. Okay.
Yes. And for some people, a foam saddle is probably not a bad option. If you're not going to have it flocked, if you're not going to have it maintained, maybe that's better than not sometimes. Those saddles are generally a lot cheaper. But you're limited on the only thing you can adjust on is with your pad. With flock saddle, there's a lot more that you can do to limit it. And something else that people don't look at is fluffing your saddles. Like you fluff your pillows up.
How do I do that?
You know how you fluff your
pillows. I know how I fluff my pillows, but how do you fluff a saddle up? Do you take it off and like do the same thing like you would a pillow? Like, poop, 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 you know?
Well, yeah, actually, you kind of do.
Do you really?
A palm mallet.
Oh, okay.
You can work with a palm mallet, and you can get that expand back out as long as you don't get your flocking too dead. And sometimes you can take a saddle and fluff it out and get where we've kind of lost on the fit and get it fluff out and get it fit nice without adding much into the saddle as far as like continue to add flocking in. One place where you get into a problem with somebody flocks saddle, they keep putting packing in. Flocking saddle, the saddle compress, you know, the flocking compresses, you keep adding more, it compresses, you keep adding more, and it compresses. Eventually, you know what you got? A baseball. And the flocking gets hard. So then you got a problem from the flocking itself. And so part of flocking saddles, and, you know, I got to say from watching people, some saddlers do not fluff out the flocking. Some saddlers do. And it's something that, you know, for myself, since I've got a palm mount, since I've got the flocking irons, and I've also got some flocking paddles that you can go reach in behind the flocking and bump it out off the tree if need be, along with my little crochet hooks to remove, you know, knots in there. If you flock, if you fluff it on a regular basis, sometimes you don't need to flock them so often. You don't even need to add much in there.
So it's a good idea to do that kind of like once a month, once every other month, twice a year.
Depends on how much you're riding. Depends on how much your horse is sweating.
Yeah.
But for myself, yes, I would, my personal saddle, I would flock it out. I mean, I would fluff it out from time to time just to keep that flocking softer. The other thing is send people to, and most everybody's good with this. But those little blue strips you can get at the woodworking shop that you can mold to stuff.
Yeah.
You know, find where the saddle foot should fit. Find the back, you know, back rotation of the scapulas. Measure that because that's about where your tree should be sitting, right behind where the scapulas rotate back. And draw down a piece of box lid, cardboard, whatever. And people are, well, I'm going to the shop to look at the saddle I want to try on my horse. And they bring it back. Oh, this is nowhere near my horse. Also, you can take that and measure down the back. We can lift the back a little bit, draw that, lay it out. We can drop it down. You can measure mid seat. You can measure at the back of the saddle of your last rib, just like you would if you were building a custom built tree. You can use that to build for a custom built tree. In fact, when Ray had me measuring trees for him, that's what we were using. And if you're you know, if money's a real problem, you can get an old coat hanger. But if you can draw that on to a piece of cardboard, poster board, whatever you got laying around, you can carry that in the saddle shop with you and send people in there folded over, walking in. People say, what are you doing? We're sticking this up in the front of the saddle to see if it's anywhere near my horse. And actually the saddle shops that are used to me doing that, they actually appreciate it at this point.
So my wife, like I said at the beginning of the show, bought a DRESCH, new saddle coming from Germany, made for her, and then she's swapping her other one out for some kind of trade discount, trade in your old model, get a new model. Mm-hmm. And she's got a Berdace, Berdades, extra wide tree with a high head and short panel. So that should be coming in this Friday. She'll probably spend all this weekend playing with it like a new toy, putting it on the horse, riding it around, seeing if it can do what it can do. I don't know if the flocker is going to come out later on during that weekend or not. So hopefully we'll have some updates on next week's show. All right, guys, stick around. When we come back, one more little segment, we'll let you get back to playing with your ponies. You're listening to Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. He'll be right back. Where'd my pen go? You okay?
Yeah.
When we come back, wrap up the show, talk briefly about the 60 minutes, talk briefly on the balance of the rider with Tony Gonzalez, and also what we just talked about
with Ray.
With Ray. Ready?
Yes.
Welcome back to Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. Don't forget, we have a YouTube video over there. We'd love for you to go over there and subscribe. And you can see those videos of Ray Morris in full length. They're broken up in three little small bite-sized segments about the how to flock or how to fit your saddle. It's called The Reason Why, and you can check those videos out there. It's an audio track, but it's got a video there that goes along with it with Ray Morris, who was blind. Now, he was blind from how old to till he passed away.
Until he passed away, it didn't, yeah. He was about 24 when he lost his vision. Ray was working, making saddles, and then his vision went.
At what age? Oh, so he was
24.
So he was making saddles already. So he knew everything about the horse, and then he slowly lost his vision, and then his feeling and everything took over.
After the losing of his vision, he was still working, making saddles. And he showed me where he ran his fingers through the sewing machine. So they kind of decided he had got him measuring saddles, and he kind of had a knack for that, and he fell into it. And then just by feel, he started noticing things in the horse's back. That's where he started getting into the body work and the massage, which goes to, you know, feel under your saddle, feel for sore spots, feel for knots, feel for that could be signs of a saddle problem.
And you can see those videos over on YouTube as well. All right, guys. All right, Mike, what did we learn today? Briefly describe the 60-minute segment that was talking about doping in the racehorse industry and how the federal government is getting involved.
Well, the federal government is definitely getting involved across the board in horse racing, as the rules are standardized across the board. It's not a state-by-state thing. Each state had a different set of rules. And there's a few bad eggs out there that are not good for the industry, and hopefully they will get that under control, and the people who are doing it right will be able to do what they do.
And we briefly read chapter 11 from the Proper Balance Movement, A Diary of Lameness, written by Tony Gonzalez, a mentor of Mike, back in his early days of his horseshoeing career. And this is just a small little segment from that. And it says, how does the rider influence this? The longer hide end and tendencies throw the rider forward, which reaches the breakover point. That is when the foot is nearly ready to leave the ground. This forward thrust will unseat the rider, and the rider's reaction could be to resist it. Now, if the rider stays in place, then the stress is not too bad, but if the rider is thrown off balance, then the rider's reaction to regain the riding position. Regaining this position is sometimes attempted by the backward push toward the hip, which unseats the person in the first place. So it's kind of like this battle back and forth.
It is very much a battle back and forth. And if you got a horse that's a chronic toe stabber, he's not reaching all the way out, he's toe stabbing on the front end, you kind of need to look at that saddle, because that can play a big part of it. Because if the scapula is not moving freely, he cannot get a full extension. If he is getting a full extension, you see this horse look like they're doing the German goose step.
Yes.
That's a false extension, and they're reaching out, the foot swings back. And there's more to it than just the saddle. Sometimes it's where the horse's nose is aimed.
And your your time that you spent with Ray Morris and the videos that we have up there on the YouTube channel, as far as Ray talking about the reason why we and how we flock saddles.
Right. I would love it if everybody would go listen to Ray and see what he has to say. There's some translation because he speaks that foreign Kiwi language.
Yeah, he's from down under.
That's right. That's like a 4x2.
Yes.
It's like a piece of lumber, 4x2, right?
No, it's a 2x4.
It's a 4x2.
Well, it's underneath the equator, so it's opposite.
Right. So there's some terms they use a little different. And good information. Horse owners should listen to it and think about it and start paying attention to the horses a little better and keep them healthy and happy for long careers.
And you can listen to those over on Equine Dynamics YouTube channel, little bite-sized pieces. You can wrap up those probably in a lunch break or something like that. You can watch those, and we appreciate if you did that as well. All right, guys, on that note, make sure you follow Mike Stein over on Facebook. Search Equine Dynamics Mike Stein. Make sure you like his page. He puts up a whole bunch of different articles up there to further education. Just like and share them over there. And also follow him on YouTube. And if you have a question for Mike Stein, go to equinedynamics.com. At the top of the page says contacts. Fill out that little form there. Ask us a question. We'll send you out some of these Dover gift cards. As long as we have them, we'll send them out. And also, if you like Mike Stein or the Equine Dynamics podcast to perform at your location or event, you can find that there as well underneath clinics. You were going to say something, Mike? No, that was it. All right, guys, on that note, on behalf of Mike Stein over there,
have a good day. Go out, enjoy your ponies.
My name is Travis Sane. See you next week.
All of the doggies are in the corral. All of your work is done. Just close your eyes and dream, little pal, dream.